Καλησπέρα σε όλους. Καλώς ήρθατε στην τρίτη διαδικτυακή συζήτηση της GTCU. Σκοπός μας είναι να δημιουργήσουμε μια κοινότητα για προπονητές τένις, αλλά και για γονείς. Σε συνέχεια της προηγούμενης μας συζήτησης που είχαμε τον Francis Roig, προπονητή του Ναδάλ, περί αγωνιστικού τένις και υψηλού αγωνιστικού τένις, αυτή την εβδομάδα έχουμε καλεσμένο τον Γκονσάλο Λόπεζ, ο οποίος είναι ειδικός σε θέματα τακτικής και θα μιλήσουμε πάνω στο τι ακριβώς είναι τακτική και πώς αυτό συμπεριλαμβάνεται στο κομμάτι του παιχνιδιού σε αγωνιστικό επίπεδο. Ο Γκονσάλο ήταν νούμερο 160 κόσμου στα Μονά και από τότε σαν προπονητής ασχολείται με την προπονητική 21 χρόνια, όπου τα 11 από αυτά δουλεύει με αθλητές ATP στο επαγγελματικό επίπεδο και αυτή τη στιγμή ουσιαστικά έχει το δικό του γκρουπ αθλητών και ασχολείται με αυτό, με τα ταξίδια και με την προπόνηση των αθλητών του. Ενρίκε.
Well, I want to make a little introduction for Gonzalo. With Gonzalo, we met in 2013 in Delray Beach. I remember that because it was a good tournament for my player over there. So you were the lucky charm over there, Gonzalo. We met also in some tournaments in a junior level in Tennis Europe, and we started building a very good relationship and friendship. Right now, Gonzalo, he's my partner. He's working with me in my academy, and he's helping with coach education to my coaches. And okay, it's a pleasure to have you here with us in our GTCU, the Greek coaching community, to talk about tactics. So hello, Gonzalo.
Hello, everybody. Hello, Greece community. And thank you for having me here. It's a pleasure. Fernand, Enrique, we have, as you said, good relationship. And it's a pleasure to work with you always. And also, through you, I meet you, Alexander. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. And I hope you like what we're going to say. Nothing else. Thank you for everybody
Fantastic.
Watching this.
And, thank you very much.
And we will have a good time.
Okay, so last week we were talking with Francis Roth and also with Spiros that they work in BTT, that's a big academy in Barcelona. You have a different way of working. Your academy, pro tennis coaching in Barcelona, has a different format. Could you a little bit explain us how is your way of working?
We have a small place. I don't even call it academy. We have a group. We handle maximum 12 players, me, my partner, and one more coach. And if we have 12 players, then we have one more coach. So we are 3-4 coaches plus a physical coach. Why I have a small format? Because I believe it's much better for the players. Why? Because if you go to big academies, you don't have the coaches that you want to. At the end, you are looking for good coaches, experienced coaches, and in big academies, you don't see them. You know, you have 20, wow. 25 coaches. So in a small academy like me, I'm always on the court with the players. Me and my partner, Mark Canovas, he was also top 400 ATP, and he has experience in the tour also. So we are always on the court with them, you know, so the player is always with us. And for me, this is the value that we are always with the player. And with this profile of coaches in big academies, it's difficult to find that. You can get a little bit lost. So in this format, everything is under control. We are daily contact with the players all day, from morning to evening. And we believe in that, and we don't need more to live. Honestly, we are super fine. Everything is under control. And like this also, we feel that that we improve better the player, that we take more from the player, you know?
Can I ask you something here?
Go ahead.
So do you think that for a Greek adolescent, like 15-year-old, who wants to go to a Spanish academy, do you think that they might go there and they might be underestimated with a lower-level coach? So they will have to start from the bottom of the chain.
you have, yes, yes. I don't want to speak about other places, but if you go to a big academy, for example, it's like if you go, if you go to a restaurant that you have 200 customers in the restaurant, you are one more. If you go to a restaurant that you have 12 customers, the cooker comes and give you the food and explain you everything, you know. So at the end, also, it's depending the experience that you want to have. If you want to have a great summer, if you want to have fun, then go to a big academy for a couple of weeks. If you want to take your tennis to another level and you want to have a professional experience and you want to have the taste of what is tennis in high level, then come to a small place, you know.
Okay. I have a question. How do you organize, how do you handle, because you have 12 players, you are 3-4 coaches, how do you handle the different levels that the players could have? For example, they get in a tournament, some of them, others they don't get in that tournament. How do you handle those organization problems?
The first thing is that they have to understand when they come is that here with us nobody is better than anyone, everybody is with everybody. Okay, I don't believe in I'm good and I'm in one corner and you are bad and you are in another corner. Okay, everybody is with everybody. And there is some work that they can do together, like, for example, baskets or some talkings they can do together. But then some work they cannot do together, and then we separate. We always find players from another places to practice with them. Okay, but at the end, is Enrique is management, is special and is management. You know, it's special and management and organization. You know,
and in the and when they go to the tournaments, I mean, for example, you have three players that they can get in futures, in the main draw, or in the qualifying, and another players they cannot, or some players you have ITF Junior that they get in, and others not.
Schedule. Everything is schedule, and also the players when they come to us. Even if we are small, it's not individual, it's not private. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if we have two or three players that goes to, let's see, ITF under 18, so we have to agree to go to the same under 18. Mm-hmm. Okay, because even if it's small, it's not private. It's the closest to private, but it's not private.
Okay? So, but you have the control of this. So you don't get, you don't let anyone to choose. Like, I mean,
We talk about the schedule. We talk about the schedule, but at the end they have to understand that this is not private. I can know me. I want to go to Italy. Me. I want to go to France. Mm-hmm. And me. I want to go to Greece. It's not working. This is not private. You know, we have to agree to a place that we go together. And some of them are in main draw. Some of them are in.
Okay.
So my understanding is that you're saying that out of the many skills that a coach should have on this level, management is one of the top, right?
Totally. This is something that we never speak. We always speak about technical things or tactical things or tennis skills, but there's another side of management, super, super important. Super important.
Okay. Fantastic.
Management of coaches, management of the team, management of schedule, management of the course, management how to grow, how of the marketing, management of control of the expenses.
Yeah. Okay, so shall we go into the theme? Yeah?
Let's go.
So what do you think tactics is? Could we give a general definition about what tactics is?
Tactics, you can see there is for sure many definitions and all of them should be fine. But for me, tactics gives you an answer to the two main objects of every game. Or in tennis games, which is how do I make points and how do I neutralize points? Okay, so tactic is trying to give you an answer for these two questions. And to give that answer, then you have to understand a few things to have to arrive to the best answer possible. Okay, because an easy answer could say, how to win points? Just hit balls to the lines. Yes, it's an answer to that question, but it's not a real answer. So to arrive to a real answer to those questions, we need more knowledge. We need to understand more points that we are going to see step by step now.
So can you repeat the second question, please?
That to arrive to a right answer
okay.
of these two questions, we have to understand a few things, because the answer is not that easy. For example, say, how do I win points? An easy answer will say, hit strong to the lines. Okay? But this is not real, not a real answer. It's not working in the real world. Okay?
So could we say that, for example, tactics is basically studying and creating a plan?
Totally.
So studying the natural rules, like what's my profile, what's my opponent's profile,
totally.
The weather conditions, and you know, all the natural laws that are important, and then studying also the natural limits, the court
totally.
Geometry,
totally.
The court geometry, the time and space between the shots. So
totally.
For creating a plan that will give more possibilities to win a match.
Totally, exactly, totally,
okay.
Totally.
Okay.
Totally, more or less like this, you know, and to give that answer, to give a right answer, before creating a plan, you have to understand a few things. Before you create, everybody knows paella, okay? Before to cook a paella, you have to understand what kind of rice, how long it takes to cook,
yes.
How is the fire? Okay, and then we create the paella. But before, there's some elements that we need to understand, or we need to have a little bit knowledge in order to create everything that you said, to create a plan or to create a game plan that I'm going to be succeed against you. Always thinking that tactic is not absolute. I mean, when you create something, it doesn't mean it's going to happen. Okay, a
yes.
tactic is a tendency. Okay,
that you will have more possibilities.
More possibilities.
Winning.
Okay,
exactly.
It's
Beautiful.
Not absolute.
Yeah.
It's not something that you say, "I'm going to do this and I win for sure." No, it's a it's a tendency. How, from where you want the game to go? I want my game to go here, or I want my game to go there. Okay,
fantastic.
And then you see how it goes in the real moment in the match. Okay.
Okay, so let's get a little bit in your philosophy. How do you understand the tactics, and how do you divide all the work, the tactical work? To start working with the player. What is your philosophy, Gonzalo?
Answer the questions you said.
Claro. Let's see what kind of rice is better for the
player. Exactly. Let's go for it.
So before, we have to understand a few things. I divide the tactics in four levels. Okay.
Okay.
So the first level is like a frame. It's like an umbrella, okay? So the frame, the first level is what kind of player you are. Okay? There is only four ways to play tennis. You are a serve and volley player, which is disappear from the game today. We are not going to discuss why it disappeared, okay? But it's disappear. Then you have a baseline aggressive player, and then you have a typical baseliner player, and you have a serve and forehand player, okay?
Can you repeat the third one?
Serve and forehand player, okay?
That's the last one.
That's the last one. You have baseline aggressive. You have baseliner aggressive player. You have a typical baseliner player, and you have a serve and forehand player, okay? So you have to put yourself in one of these three. The more pure you are in one of these three, the better player you are, okay? For example, today we are living in an era, we are living in a time that is super easy to identify these three ways of playing, which is baseliner aggressive is Djokovic, baseliner is Rafa, and serve and forehand is Federer, okay? And every frame, I call it this a frame of tactic. Why? Because every frame, every player has some identities. Okay, to be competitive, what is competitive? Competitive is the ability to keep a rally. If I play a rally with Rafa, I am not competitive. I don't have the level. So when you are competitive, you have the ability to keep the rally with the other one. So in order to be competitive, the first thing is to have a good frame. And every frame has identities. Identities that match that way of playing. Okay? So Djokovic is playing one way, Rafa one way, and Federer one way. And to play this way, we need different identities. A different mind, different fitness, different swing, different footwork, different point of contacts. There's some identities. But for tactics, the most important identities is two. Is every frame has a formula to win points, and every frame has a level of aggressivity. Okay? So, and every formula to win points is looking for one thing, always, which is how arrives the easy ball for me. Okay? How arrives the easy ball? So I can make the winner or I can make the final shot. So in baseline aggressive, the formula is I'm going to hit a high rhythm of balls until you cannot catch up the rhythm anymore and you leave me an easy ball. The baseliner is I'm going to open you high balls to open you big spaces. I'm going to keep you very behind until you are out of the point and you leave me the easy. And the serve and forehand is I'm going to hit you forehands as strong everywhere around the court, starting with myself, until you cannot catch up the rally and you leave me the easy. Okay, so this is the main goal of every tactic. The main goal of every tactic is how the easy ball arrives to me. And the first step is, where are you as a player? Okay?
Okay, so first the player has to understand what are his strengths,
which identity are you as a player?
And then we start building from there.
And you start building a player from there. You don't build players with everything, with all the tools. Okay? Rafa has different tools than Djokovic. The player is not complete. Rafa is better in one area, and the other one is better in another area.
Okay.
And if you realize every frame matches one core. Baseline aggressive is a super competitive way of playing on hardcore. Baseline is a super competitive way on clay court, and serve and forehand is super competitive way in indoor. Mm-hmm. Okay, and the surface, clay, indoor, or hard court, creates the formula. If you play with the formula on clay, hard court, you are not that competitive. If you play with the formula of serve and forehand on hard court, you are not that competitive. Of course, at higher level, all of them are competitive, but from 10 French Open, Rafa will win 9 and Djokovic 1. And from 10 US Opens, Djokovic will win 9 and Rafa 1. And from 10 Masters in indoor, Federer will win 9 and Djokovic 1 or 2. Okay, so every frame matches one core, one surface.
Okay, you say that you cannot do everything, a player cannot do everything. When do you think you start building the player? Because when the kids are little, you are working everything. You are giving them all the shots, all the knowledge, how to play different balls. And when do you start making the definition of this style?
You make the definition because of three things. First of all, the guy who coaches you. Okay. For example, if you have Boris Becker as a coach, will teach you different than if you have Rafa Nadal as a coach. Okay. First, the coach has influence over the player. Mm-hmm. Second is the understanding of the game, the natural understanding of the game from the player, how the player understands the game. For example, Carlos Moya is a player from Spain, but he's not typical Spain. Okay, so he understands tennis another way. And the third reason, and the more important thing, is where you are born. If you are born in a country with clay courts, so you are going to develop to a baseliner. If you are born in a country with hardcore, you're going to develop to a more hardcore, a more baseliner aggressive. Why? Because the whole environment of that country has that knowledge. This is called the schools of tennis. Mm-hmm. For example, in USA, you will not see clay court players. In Argentina, you will not see serve and forehand players. In Spain, you will not see Federer. You see, the school creates identity in the player. Why? Because the schools, the countries, the areas, has a typical surface. In Spain, the Mediterranean coast, we have clay. In Argentina, they have clay. In Europe, they have indoor. So if you see all the players from indoor countries like North Germany, Austria, Sweden is different. All those countries, they have serve and forehand players. Argentina, Spain is clay court. USA is baseline. Now everything is more mixed. Everything is more mixed because the players, they travel much more to learn to another places. But it's important to have all this clear in the head. So that will tell you which path are you going. That will tell you which is the north. Mm-hmm. Which direction are you going? Okay? If you don't... Tell me.
I have a question. Like, I understand all this and I've been thinking about it a lot as you were speaking. So you spoke about the umbrella, yeah? The first level, the frame, the game style. And then you said you have four game styles. The one that is slowly or even dead, serve and volley. You have the typical baseliner, like Nadal. You have the aggressive baseliner, like Djokovic. And you have the serve and forehand, like Federer. Okay, so I'm thinking this, I like it very much because in a lot of it I agree, but all of them are baseliners. All of those styles, it refers only to baseline. So for I would categorize Federer as an all-around player where he can play every shot from every possible point of the court.
All of them are baseliner, but they are different baseliners. The position on the court is different. Rafa is more behind, Djokovic more inside, Federer is more inside. So you can say Federer is all around court position. It's like, but it's not serve and volley. We call it baseline aggressive because the other baseliner is a little bit more passive. It's a little bit more waiting what is going to happen.
I understand this. You know? I understand this, but I'm asking basically about player categorization, player profiling. There is no inclusion of the second part of the court, the closer part. Like a lot of players are good at that. They can play in a high level. Other players, they are average. So for example, Federer is very comfortable from that area of the court. Rafa is also very comfortable from that area of the court. He has a high percentage in successive volleys. Djokovic wasn't so much, now he has become a little bit more. So that area of the court doesn't play an important role in categorizing a player.
No, because that area of the court is a consequence of how good you rally. If you rally bad, you cannot go to the net with guarantees. If you rally good, then you can come to the net. Serve and forehand players, they have a game that they could develop to the net. For example, Sampras was serve and forehand and he was going to the net a lot. Federer is not going that much. Fernando González was not going that much. So after, in every category, you have players who could develop a little bit this way, a little bit that way. You understand? For example, Murray, which was made in Spain, 15, 16, 17. He's very close to baseline. And he doesn't come to the net too much, even if he has great volley. So all that area of the game is related how good you rally. So I will not put it in umbrella. It's a consequence of how good you do that.
Okay, understood.
No? So So everything is clear here. We need a north. We need a path. Okay. So this is for me the first level to understand. The second one is we have to understand a little bit the game of tennis. Okay. And in tennis, the game of tennis creates positions like any other game. Okay. We have in tennis, we have all the games you attack and you defend. So in tennis, not different. We have, historically, there is three situations. It's attacking, it's defending, and it's neutral. Okay. I consider today five situations, which is attacking. I related to the finish point. So for example, if you come to the net and this is the finish point, it's attacking. Leading, which means I lead the rally. I am leading the rally. I am the one who hitting where I want to. Neutral, nothing happened. Blocking, defensive. Defensive is extremely defensive. And blocking is, I'm not defensive, but I'm blocking all the shots. Rafa used that a lot. Okay, he's not out of position yet. Okay, so we have to understand these five situations super well.
Can you repeat them one more time, please?
Yes, I'm going to share the screen. Okay.
Okay.
And I'm going to explain this a little bit better with the screen. Okay.
Okay, let's go.
So we have the core here. Okay. So wait 1 second. Where is? Okay. Vale. So we have defensive. We have blocking. We have neutral, we have leading, defensive, blocking, neutral,
attacking.
Leading, and attacking, okay? So the defensive is extremely defensive when we are out of the position already. Blocking is, we are blocking, we are not defensive, we are still in the rally. Neutral, nothing happened. Leading, I am hitting the balls where I want to. The other one is running more than me. I am leading the rally, okay? And attacking is the shot that I'm going to finish the point. So the key is when I am in every situation, okay? So the player has to understand super well in which situation he is. And to understand this, I use this. For example, when you start the game, okay, this is the player, and this is the player, okay? Sorry, the lines, I don't have too much touch. So, this line, okay, is how they call the height of the game, the height of the game. So, when the opponent in a rally makes you hit behind, makes you go backwards, you enter in defensive. When the rally allows you to go forward, you enter in offensive. It's super easy. But when you go to a high level, it's not that obvious. When you are in players with 10 years old, 12, this situation is very obvious. The other one goes behind, the other one goes forward, okay? And this line, we have a distance here. So if I go behind, for example, here, the other one, the game allows you to go inside, so we have the same distance, okay? So we have to try to keep always the same distance with the player. It's like a dancing, okay? If you understand this, you identify very well in which situation you are. Typical mistake is of the players when they are they don't have too much knowledge is when they are defending, they want to attack. When they have to attack, they don't push. Okay, they don't have clear, especially today, that nobody wants to defend. Everybody wants to attack. Okay, so the first thing that the player needs to do is to understand this super, super clear. Okay, you follow all this?
Yes, totally.
Totally? Okay, vale. And also, you have to understand a few things about the situations. Is that the situations, they never come together. Okay, both of them are attacking, or both of them are defending. One is defending, one is attacking. For example, this situation goes with this one. This situation goes with this one. And this is the only one that both players are at the same time. When I am leading, you are blocking. When I am attacking, you are defending. When you are leading, I am blocking. All the situations go separately. They never go together in both players. Another question you have to understand about the situations is that they can change in one shot. Every shot is a different situation. Every shot is a possibility to change the situation. You are not always defending for 10 shots, or you, if you have the knowledge, you are leading for 10 shots. But mentally, you have to understand that every shot, the situation could change.
So this can happen in the middle of one point. You can pass from defending to blocking and after to leading and then go back, depending on how the rally goes. You can have everything in one point.
In the same point, you can have all the situations, every shot. Mm-hmm. Okay. And you have to, the third question is you have to understand that every situation you play different. You don't play different when you don't play the same when you are blocking than when you are leading. You don't play the same when you are defensive than when you are attacking. You play different in every situation. And the last one, for me, the most important thing is from one situation to another situation, you do it in three times. You don't go straight from one situation to another. The first step is the intention. I want to do something, for example, okay? If I want to enter in leading, I have to push this guy behind, as we said before. So my mind, my intention is the shot is I want to do that. The second one is the confirmation. Yes, this is happening. And the third one is the execution. Is I do the shot, okay? So if, as we said before, if we have to keep this line, okay? If my intention is to push and go, and I go too quickly inside, and I stay here, maybe that guy hits deep, I'm out. Okay, so you have to understand these three phases, the three steps of changing situation. When you understand all this very quickly, very well, now we are giving, it's a little bit more complicated, I don't want to be extended too much. When you understand this very well, you play coordinated with the other player. Okay, the goal, the purpose of this is to be coordinated with the other player. Be coordinated with the situations. If you are not coordinated with the situations, you are not following the game. For example, when if I go to volley, you don't come to volley. You are not coordinated. If I come to volley, you're gonna make me a passing shot. Okay? So you have to be coordinated in these situations. This is super, super,
so take,
important.
So take the correct decisions. Let's
totally.
Say,
it's
to
super
take
important.
The correct decisions, to read the game and take the correct decisions.
Super important, okay? Super important. So, to finish this block, as we said before, the attacking or leading or attacking, we could put both situations in a group, is when I push the other one behind, okay? So this is the guy. If I push him behind, I'm starting to lead. So leading or attacking is not related to a position of the court. For example, it's not here I am attacking and here I am defending. Leading or attacking is related to who is pushing backwards to whom. For example, if you are here and I am here, and from here, I push you, I am attacking. And you are inside, and I am outside, okay? Obviously, if you are inside, you will have more possibilities to win the point from outside. But you have to understand in your mind that basically, the one who attacks, the one who leads, is the one who push the other one behind, no matter where are you on the court. this is super beautiful in tennis. It's a super beautiful situation. Why? Because tennis is the only is one of the few games that you play outside the court. You can play outside the court. For example, in soccer, you have to play inside the court. But tennis, you can play outside. So if this is the core, for me, this is one of the best thing. This is the core, and this is the core. The core also could be this one. We have the same distance. So you can play here. There's no problem. The only problem is here that the angles are more. You know, if from here you have these angles, from here you have these angles. So you have more distance to run. But basically the core is the same. Is that because we can attack from outside? Is that because when the other one is attacking me, if the other one is here hitting in this line and I am here, the core is exactly the same. You follow all this? You follow all this?
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes, sure. So,
you very, know? Very interesting.
So this is this understanding. Now here we're giving a little explanation. This understanding is, for me, super important in the player. This is the core of the game. You have to understand this super, super well. Okay? Super well. Because these lines, this possibility to go backwards or to go forward, will tell me that I have to move inside or outside. Okay?
Sure.
Inside or outside. Tennis, again, that we move in or out. In or out. We don't move like this. We move inside or outside. Okay? Sure. And we always have to try to get that movement to go inside. We always try to go inside because we have more possibilities to win the point than from outside. Okay, we are more efficient in the first goal of the game, which is a way to make points. If I am here, I have more possibilities to win the point than if I am here. Okay, but I'm not going to be here by a system. I have to find something that allows me to be there. Okay.
Okay.
Vale, this is Gonzalo, the second block. This is understanding.
Can I make you a question now?
Go ahead.
So nowadays, like talking about tactics, I know your philosophy, and also it's like the Spanish way of thinking, like building the point, trying. From a defense.
Enrique, I don't like to say this Spanish way of thinking. Everybody's building points in different ways. Mm-hmm. Even Federer is building points. But we relate Spain because Spain is on clay court. So what happened on clay court? Well, we need more balls
working more
to build that
more.
Point because the court is slower. The offensive power of the court is lower than the defensive power. Mm-hmm. If you play on hardcore, maybe you need less balls to build because the offensive power of the core is higher than the defensive power. And if you go to grass, you need only two or three balls to build a point because the offensive power of the surface is higher than the defensive. So I will not say a Spanish way. I will say tennis, you play like this in any player in any surface. The mm-hmm. difference is how long it takes to build a point.
Yes, like I mean that nowadays this is shortening. This is what I want to get.
Shortening.
It's getting so you need less shots to get.
You need less shots because what's the difference between the 70s, the tennis of the 70s and tennis today? In the 70s, you had to make a winner from here. Today, mm-hmm. you can make winners from here. You know? So in the 17s, if I defend an easy ball here, I could keep playing tennis, no problem. But today, if you defend an easy ball and it's here, the winner comes. Not, it's not a winner, but maybe I'm totally out of the point. Okay? So
I have a question.
Tell me.
May I ask, please? Thank you. So before you said, and correct me if I'm wrong, that where you are on court doesn't play such an important role into your decision making. Is that correct?
No, I say that that you can lead or you can attack from any position on the court.
Okay. So, but however, yes. However, advising a 14-year-old, a 16-year-old, a 20-year-old professional player to attack from the baseline, from behind the baseline, in a neutral situation, is not will not help him, right? Like, he will need to find positions on court that will be more high percentage shots.
This goes to the third block. Your questions goes to the third block. That if you want to, we go ahead of that, of course. Everybody is looking for this, for leading. For okay. leading, of course. If you lead from here, it's much better than to lead from here. Okay? Why? Why? Because what is the objective of the game? This is the player, this is the player. The objective of the game is that the ball goes behind you. It bounces and goes behind you. Okay, so if you are closer, my objective is you. This is you, and this is my objective, that the ball goes away. So if I am closer to the objective, the possibilities are higher. If I am farther from the objective, the possibilities are lower. So what we try to...
The objective could be also the ball to bounce twice,
but mainly the main objective is that the ball passes. Okay. Now we go to the third block, that you will understand this question that you tell me much better, which is how I create a tactic. Okay. How is the structure of the tactic? Okay.
Okay.
So, but. I mean, it's difficult to explain now by Zoom, by video, all this, okay? But I hope you have
I think you will have to come in Greece to make a practical, like a practical lesson here.
On court is much easier and much better to understand, okay? But this is the understanding of the game. The player has to understand these situations, how from one situation I go to another one, that if I'm very behind of the court, that doesn't mean anything. I have to be comfortable that I can play from there. Of course, the objective is to be more inside, but if I'm outside, nothing happens. This is the understanding of this game, okay? That will give him quietness here in the mind, okay? We go forward, okay? A structure. The first thing when you beat a tactic is to have a diagonal. Which diagonal I am going to play against you? One diagonal that I stabilize the game, one diagonal that I control, and one diagonal that I can start building. Super perfect example is Rafa against Federer. This is Rafa, this is Federer. So which diagonal takes Rafa? This one. Okay, when something is wrong, when he wants to stabilize the game, he goes to that diagonal, which is my best shot against your worst shot. Okay, so when you're going to play against a player, which diagonal I pick, which diagonal that I feel comfortable. It doesn't mean it could be my best shot. Maybe it's not my best shot, but in that diagonal, my game is stabilized. Okay, I am fine. Nothing happened. I can rally with you with no threat. Okay. And now when you pick a diagonal, you have to pick a system to open spaces, okay? If we don't open spaces, we cannot win points. And this is the question that you answered me, that you were asking me before, Alexander. And there is only three ways to open spaces, which is by combination of shots. Is one short, one deep. One deep, one short, or one deep and one deeper, okay? So every shot that you follow the combinations, the space gets bigger and the possibilities to make the point is bigger. For example, if I hit you short here, you are coming here, I open the space here. If the next one goes here, from here you go here, then I open all the space here. So every shot that you follow the combinations, the space gets bigger and the possibilities to win the point gets higher. If you don't open spaces, you cannot win points. Hitting strong is not a tactic. Hitting strong is a skill. Today we say you have to be more aggressive. This is not a tactic, in my opinion. Okay? A tactic is how I pick a diagonal and how I'm going to make combinations with you.
So you spoke open about spaces. you spoke about three systems to open spaces.
Yes.
One of them is short deep.
I repeat. Two? One of them is if I hit you short and the next one deep.
Yes.
The other one is if I hit you deep and the next one short. And the other one is if I hit you deep and the next one deeper.
Okay.
Okay. So okay. Every time that you follow these combinations, the space gets bigger and the possibilities are better. So the goal is to be always leading. Okay. And to lead, leading means I know how to open, I know how to play with the combinations. So the other one, the other player, doesn't push me behind, and I'm always pushing behind. Then I'm a great leader mm-hmm. in the rally. Okay? So the goal is to be a great leader, because from leading, you will arrive to aggressive. From leading, you will arrive here. From leading, you will have the easy ball. If you don't know how to lead, nothing will happen. Nothing will happen. Okay.
Question.
And this is this is how a structure. Let me finish 1 minute. This is how I structure this. And in order to structure this, Alexander, as you said before, you have to understand your level. You have to understand your skills. You have to understand what you can do, what you cannot do. You have to understand the conditions. You have to understand the moment of confidence that you are. You have to understand the moment of confidence of the other one. You have to understand all these variabilities. Okay?
Certainly, certainly. Tactics in tennis is probably the most complex tactics in all sports.
It's the most complex one. But because, for example, imagine Alexander, I'm going to play against you, and you have
no
a
bet.
I know. and imagine that I see you play the match before, and when somebody slides to you, you don't know how to handle that, and then I'm going to play to you, but my friend, I don't know how to slice, so I cannot use it. I cannot use it as a tactic.
So,
I have to find something that my skill allows me to do. You know?
So can I ask you now one thing that I had from the third element you spoke about. So you spoke about first, it's important to stabilize, find the diagonal that is comfortable to stabilize. Okay, feel safe, rally there, and you are in the...
You start there.
Okay, so the second thing you said is to create a system to open space. So you spoke about the three systems. And then you said that the goal is to lead, is to attack, is to gain
to
more
lead,
space,
to
gain
lead.
More, yes, gain more still time from your opponent. So... to do that, you have to use the appropriate combinations to push them behind. So my question is this. What if I have a player who feels very comfortable in the depth of the court and can hit like very, very heavy topspin and stays and feels comfortable there? So how do I bring this? Like, what is the tactic I use to get him where he is uncomfortable, which could be inside the court?
He has to understand that only hitting balls from behind, he will not damage. This is a developing of the player. If he is super comfortable, let's see, behind the court, hitting balls, this is super good. But the key now is to develop that player from that starting point to go a little bit more forward. Okay? Because if you stay there, you will not win. If Rafa stays only behind, just hitting balls, he will not win. He's doing that to go forward and to try to progress on the court. You know?
Yeah, but won't against one player who is still developed in playing from behind and not so developed from playing from close. Wouldn't I advise my player to find ways to take them out of their comfort zone? Not necessarily to push them back.
No,
I don't
my
want
player,
that player so to push him back.
If you are playing against, for example, I share the screen now again.
Okay.
Here. Okay, you are playing, your player is here, the other one, the opponent is here, yes or not?
Yes.
And he's super comfortable and he hits all the balls deep and I cannot go inside. So what you have to do is to take this guy out of here.
Okay.
You have to make him go inside. You have to hit short, okay, so he goes inside, so then I have to hit deep. So now if this guy stays here, he's comfortable. If I'm going to play against you, I have to take you out of here. No?
Yes.
You seen the combinations. You are here, so the combination is short angle,
short angle,
I come here, you see, I'm already taking you. And then I have a little space here. Then the next one goes here, you know, but if I only hit inbox and this guy is running here and you don't open spaces, will be difficult to win because at the end you will get crazy. You will play tennis
so you do create space not only by pushing them back, but also by bringing him forward as well.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, but look at this. We bring him forward to push him back again.
Yes.
Because if he stays here, I cannot push him behind. So we bring him forward with a passing stop. To push him behind. No?
Okay. No, it's clear.
Okay. So and this comes the more complete is the player, the more tools he has, the more confidence, the more tools. Then it comes skills, ability, develop the player, find the right combinations in the right moment against that guy. As I said before, when you start to plan all this, which we go to the fourth level. Which is the fourth level is pure creating. You as a coach, you create all this. Then it comes the experience. It comes how much tennis you see. It comes the feeling you have. Where is your player? In which moment is your player? In which moment is the other player? That comes the level. That comes the creating. And also, you have to have the skill to change quickly because, for example, imagine I'm telling you, let's open the guy here on cross short. But in that particular moment, the guy is hitting super balls deep. So I need to change quickly in the same moment, in the same match, you know? So as I said before, tactics are a tendency. It's not something that will happen for sure, yes or yes. You know, it's a tendency. So this is the fourth level. The fourth level is pure creation, pure creative, pure improvisation, and it comes from your experience, from your knowledge, from the knowledge of the player, from the communication that you have with the player. That comes from there, you know. And this is something that is difficult. It's difficult to teach. You know, it's difficult to teach. You have to do it with time, by yourself, with your own experience, with your eye. For example, it's super important, the eye. For example, why? The eye, some players, let's hit to the forehand. The forehand, for example, this diagonal, I'm winning. But maybe the ball, if you hit here or here, it's a huge difference.
So?
You know, that comes the eye, which how much sharp is your eye? Okay? This is the fourth level. It's pure creating. Put all this together and create something that is gonna help me in the match in that particular moment. Because also you have to think that I play with you today, and maybe the match is one way. And I play with you tomorrow, and the match could go in another way. Okay,
very so true.
So this is creating. I have to have high experience. You know, this is the fourth level. The fourth level is time and watch tennis, matches, mistakes. Of course, I make many mistakes doing tactics. I make mistakes, of course, and you learn from those mistakes. I mean, nothing happens.
Fantastic, fantastic. You know? So from your experience working with a lot of ATP players here, and you have a big match, to make that a little bit more practical, what would be your, let's say, five main advice you would give to your players before, let's say, a first round of Grand Slam or a quarterfinal of ATP 250? What would be the most important tactical elements you would give?
The first thing is get the match rallying with the other one. Get the rally. You know, the first thing is get used to the rally. Because if you are not used to the rally, if you are not comfortable with the rally, you cannot build anything. You cannot build anything. If you fall from the bicycle, you cannot win the race. You know, it's very simple. You know, so the first thing is get comfortable in a rally. Because in some matches, for example, Timur Gavashvili, he played in round of 16 in US Open French Open against Roddick. He was top five. And the first thing I said to him is, get used to his rally. Okay, you have top five in the world, central court, so you have to control your emotions and let's start to get used to the rally. Okay?
Feel the rhythm
of the rally. When you feel that, then you start to, your emotions comes down and then you can start to build something. You know,
beautiful.
You can start
beautiful.
To build something. So the first thing is this. The second thing for me, super important, is your percentage of serves has to be high. Okay? If you are missing first serves, go down and make second first. Don't worry, you know, if it's not strong. But don't put you in a position that you are going to be emotionally nervous because you are missing many first serves or because the other one is attacking me on the second serve. So avoid all that. You know, you may not make winners, you may not be aces, but you know, put the first serve in. The first serve has to be high. And also the second one, put the returns inside. Okay? Don't miss returns, especially in the second serves. Don't miss returns. So if you can achieve these three things, then you are already in the match.
You are in the match. Starting the points and playing the rally, competitive.
You are in the match. And then let's go to the second part, which is how I can win you points. But if you don't complete these three things, it's super difficult to go to the second part. You don't go.
So simple and so important. Wow.
So important. Yes. You know, because we go to see many kids, especially in under 16, under 18, the rally out, many mistakes in returns, the first serve is out. So how can you create something? It's super difficult. It's super difficult to create something from that point, you know?
Okay, I have a question there. So when you have a player, you want him to start the game doing what he does well, or you are going to build a tactic depending on who is he playing? This is
always we try to build a tactic from what I do better, mm-hmm. from what I do better, from my strong things. From my strong things, okay.
Your advantages.
Yeah, I'm not passive saying because the other one is playing like this, going to play like that. No, the point of starting is how I play and how I do this.
I do my strategy, my points, the way I play, and then we'll see if. But maybe you know the other player and you know that he has some weakness somewhere. Maybe you adapt a little bit this tactic.
You take one diagonal, you know, you open here, you open there, but always from my point of view, not from the point of view of the other one.
Perfect.
No?
So, fantastic.
Okay.
Yeah, I think.
And then I don't know. To practice all this as we did with Enrique when I went to Greece. Remember, Enrique was what was that?
November.
In November. Hmm. So then with exercises that to learn how to rally, to understand the situations and. But at the end is more than exercises is talking to the players. Mm-hmm. It's talking a lot, you know. Now this that, is, now is that, you know.
To make them understand. To make them
understand the game, you know. And then when they understand all this, when they understand the game, they feel more comfortable, they feel more secure. They understand better what I can do, what I cannot do, when I can do it, when I cannot do it. And then Alexander and Enrique, and then the player starts to have order. Mm-hmm. It's a word that we say a lot in Spain. The player has order, you know? And when a player has order, it's difficult to beat them. It's very difficult to beat with order, you know?
So very true. Difficult.
All right, Gonzalo, it was very, very interesting for our conversation about tactics.
We can be speaking like 3 hours, 4 hours about tactics. It's amazing.
I hope that you are watching the video.
I always say, Enrique, I don't say I'm right. You know, when I speak to people or when I listen to people, I always say verify by yourself. Okay, don't take us. This is the truth. You verify the information by yourself if it's working or not, or if it's used for you or not. You know, it's the same that when I listen to people, I don't take it the first time.
You get the information that it's useful for you.
And I want to verify. I want to know if it's working. Okay, I want to check if it's working. And normally, if I listen to qualified people, it's working, of course, you know.
But
first, I want to say, I want to know. I want to understand if it's working. You know? I don't take it just for granted, like if it's the real truth. You know?
Okay.
Yes, filter all the information. Filter them.
Filter.
So we are going to organize GTCU is going to organize a webinar in June. Like we will say the exact date, in which we will be talking about the pathway that the athlete has to follow since they start playing until they become a professional or they get in a very high level that it allows them to go also to a college, like to play a very good tennis level. We will go through all the stages from 10 years old, under 12, under 14, 16, 18, and so. We will analyze it with Gonzalo López. So we will explain in the following days how you will register for the.
And also we will have the second subject, which is how you become a coach, international coach. If this is your goal, if this is your dream, or this is the way you want to live. This is the tennis is very big, okay. And one corner is international coaching. So if you want to decide to go that way, how can you do it?
Yes. And also not only for people who dream to become like elite coach, but also for coaches who are in a specific level and they don't know what they need to do to get to the next one. What skills exactly every stage requires for you to go higher up the ladder. And again, it will be really helpful for new coaches, fresh coaches who want to know exactly what they need to do in order to achieve whatever they want to achieve.
We will try to inspire them a little bit to to give them information of where they are, how they want to go here, if they want to go there, which is another aspect of tennis that we spoke the beginning, which is technical, tactical, which is the management, and now is the path. Which path I'm going, where I want to be, you know, and what do I have to do, and all these things.
All right. Yes. So if you like our way of explaining things together with Gonzalo, you will have a very good experience, and you will, I believe, you will learn a lot of things. You will get a lot of things as a professional. So Gonzalo, thank you very much. Thank you very much for your time to share with all of us, with our community, all this knowledge about tactics. And we will be in touch and we will be soon together here at
GP. By the way, it's a super good initiative that both of you they had for the Greece, for tennis in Greece. Is what you're doing is super value, super Thank value. You. Greece is a place that right now with Chichipas is well known, but tennis with this platform for sure, step by step, there's more information, and for sure the tennis step by step will go a little bit higher. You are doing a fantastic job and it's super fantastic.
This is the goal.
Thank you very much.
Sharing information, working all together, and going high to the next level.
For Greek tennis.
My friends.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Take care. Thank you very much, Gonzalo.
Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.